we have a specimen, we can go and check that and see if the identification has been right. But the field observation, this is not possible. And in any case, the only way of solving a misidentification is through close re-examination by an expert taxonomist, what we call a curation of taxonomic names. But as I said, they might not be solved. And the third issue we're going to see is the taxonomic level emptiness. This has to do with the taxon concept more than with taxon names. So the seriousness of this illness depends on the missing levels. And the importance increases as the taxonomic rank increases. So if we have file information and we don't have kingdom information, that's not a hard issue because we can easily check the name of the file and see what kingdom it's applied, and then figure out the kingdom value. But what happens if, for example, the scientific name is the one that's missing? We don't know, we cannot be sure which specific species there are. Still, some of the higher levels are also crucial when in cases such as the homonymous and synonymous. If we don't have the middle levels of two homonym names, single name, how do we know to which organism it's applied to? There's no way to do so. So these three issues we have already seen, misspellings, identification, and emptiness, are issues that happen due to the human interaction with the names. But there are some other issues that arise due to the nature of taxonomy itself. Taxonomy can be so messy that issues might appear natural. For example, not defining the use of taxonomy when you identify an organism has the same effect as having only the scientific name. We have no information on the background of that name. We don't know who described that species or which taxonomic hierarchy or classification is applying to that scientific name. So we might take the default classification, complete the higher levels, and we say, okay, that's solved, but how reliable is that? How can we truly know that we have done it well? So the solution is to provide the employed taxonomy that's the same as giving the taxonomic concept, not the name. And also the use of identification qualifiers such as sensu. Sensu means in the sense of. So if we say Avis alba sensu over X, or Pipistrellus gallus sensu, this specific taxonomic classification or taxonomic hierarchy, then the problem is solved. Because we have context applied to that thing. The case of synonymous and homonymous might look like similar. And again, some background information is mandatory to unambiguously know of which name are we speaking. Either providing background information or giving it an identification qualifiers, this issue can be solved in modern terms. And the third one, due to the instability of taxonomic identification, is that in these cases of taxonomic instability, having background information is helpful, but also having a source of the changes in taxonomic names. So the iNaturalist is an organization, it's a source of biodiversity information in general, which has a specific application which is called taxon change, taxonomic changes, which is aimed to record every single modification in the taxonomic names or the taxonomic classification. So for example, if we go to the taxonomic change services in iNaturalist, we can select and see all the taxonomic splits have happened, which are all the ones they are aware of. Or all the taxonomic merges, or the disappearing of taxonomic names. This is a really helpful tool if we are working with doubtful taxonomic information. So now that we know which are the most common issues, let's see how to assess them. So the aim of a taxonomic assessment is to correct the issues, to reconcile taxonomies, which means disambiguate a taxonomic information, a taxonomic description, identification, and to complete hierarchies. The basic general process requires the use of controlled vocabularies, of controlled name lists, and the process would be something like taking the name, checking the list, if that name exists, extracting the related information from the authoritative source, and then applying the needed changes. The key here is to have a reliable list of names. And this can be achieved by going to different taxonomic information sources. The most general source of taxonomic information are what we call the general databases, which ideally are global, high-quality sources of taxonomic information. The problem with these ones is that they rely on some other taxon-specific sources, and they depend on the completeness of these sources and the existence of sources for all the groups in order to be complete. So if we are missing, for example, specific source for orthoptera, then our global database won't have any information on their phone. An example of this is using the catalog of life database, which seems to be the most comprehensive database of taxonomic names and taxonomic classifications. A second level is to use thematic databases and or regional checklists. If our collection is taxon specific, or is regimen specific, this might be a good approach, because these are usually seen as a very reliable alternative sources of taxonomic information that's applied to a certain taxonomic group or a certain place. And their aim is to gather all available knowledge on these topics. Some examples of these are the index fungorum for fungi names, for the taxonomy, the ITIS for American biodiversity, or something more specific like the genetic database from the London National Institute of Natural Research. If none of this work, if the general databases don't work, and there's no thematic database or regional checklist for our data, we can still do something. We can still go to the taxonomic literature. We can search for specific literature on our taxonomic groups or our groups. So this is the most specific source, which has very, very high reliability information. In fact, the rest of the sources, the general databases and the thematic databases, take their information from taxonomic literature. The problem is that it's hard to retrieve relevant literature, both in time and resources. And the names information is not really available. You have to do some processing to extract the information so that you can use it. So this is what I meant with the reliable list of names to check our data. But still, our data has to meet some requirements in order to be usable. So our taxonomic information must be free of misspellings. It can be free of misspellings initially, in the beginning, or we can apply some tools to reduce misspellings to the minimum. If we have misspelled names, we won't be able to check them against our sources. So we won't be able to find the information related to our original data. So some of the tools we have already seen, like we refine, processing, Excel, or any other spreadsheet, are very helpful to accomplish this. They're really good at allowing us to reduce the prevalence of misspellings. And the taxonomic reconciliation depends on this, depends on having clean names in the first place. Another requirement is to have the taxonomic data complete at a certain level, at least to a certain point, which is the scientific name, meaning. But in identification process. For example, having the person who identified that, having the author that described the name, having the taxonomic classification that has been used, it's really helpful. And sometimes it's mandatory to be able to assess and claim our taxonomic data. So there are two broad types of taxonomic assessment methods, manual and automatic. When processing taxonomic information manually, our aim is to remove inconsistencies and obtain the wrong information. I want you to know that taxonomy is in fact an interpretation of both explicit and implicit knowledge. Explicit knowledge comes from the records. Implicit knowledge is something we can't have directly, we must deduce it. So, for example, if we don't have the use taxonomy, we might still know, if we don't have the use taxonomy but know who made the identification, we might know which taxonomy or which classification does that person use. And so, we can deduce an implicit knowledge on the taxonomy classification. So machines, computers, are not good at working with implicit knowledge. They can't deduce still. So manual assessment is, at some point, in fact, it's something that's recommended in a certain part of the assessment process. But it's prone to errors, because working manually, we can make mistakes. So automatic approach is also recommended. The ideal way is to mix both systems. Automatic approaches are good for big amounts of data and are good for doing repetitive tasks, such as the removal of misspellings, or checking against the source, or updating information that we have the good data. But it only works with explicit knowledge. So we have to be sure of making the implicit data explicit so that it can be used in an automatic approach. So what would be the sequence in this session? Suppose we have a list of taxonomic names or taxonomic classifications enough. So the first step would be to apply all the automatic approaches we have seen. Use the global databases, use the regional checklist or thematic databases in order to reduce as much as possible the common issues, so that we can clean them up, we can clean most of the errors with one single movement. Still, some of the records might be difficult to clean. Might be automatic approaches won't be able to do so. So in this case, the manual checking of all the remaining cases is mandatory in order to have a good end. And what happens after the taxonomic assessment and in fact the assessment? We have to validate the output. We have to validate what we have done. Because we want to know how much data has been corrected, what data could not be corrected, and how much data, if any, has gone worse. We might have introduced some inaccuracies when processing the data, so we have to check if we've done something. In the case of taxonomic validation, the only way to do so is by using an expert, consulting an expert. Because he's the one who belongs to a group that can effectively mix both the implicit and explicit knowledge, so they can see if the explicit knowledge was enough to clean this information. So this process is not completely automatic. And if assessment fails, then what we can do depends on if the data is ours or not. If the data is ours, then we have to document